like anything I ever seen. Feels like the right direction. Cause you're next to
today's episode of Roz's Happy Hour. I'm your girl, Roz. What's happening, everybody? This is the last Wednesday of the year. It's our last show of the year. But let me start off by giving God thanks for keeping us through this year, through all the turbulence. Thanking him for this broadcast, to be able to bring you the best in arts and entertainment. Your continued support is most appreciative. And I hope you guys had a chance to check out our last show with Johnny Gill. We had a ball. Johnny and I was chopping it up. Be sure to check it out on Roz's Happy Hour YouTube channel, where you can actually see all of our previous broadcasts. And please subscribe while you're there. So, and if you would, could you please share the link for me so we can get people in there? Hey, I see you, Walt. What's happening? Hey, Alex. Good evening. Bobby, Sister Bobby, how are you? Anyway, so we can party with everyone. Please share the link and follow us on all of our pages. Well, I'm going to just jump right in because we got a lot going on today to our broadcast, and bring on some of my friends to help close out this year on Roz's Happy Hour. So let's welcome my girl. This is my beastie. She's a singer herself, has sung with Tina Marie. Now she sings with Ziggy Marley. And then I'm going to welcome, we have another beastie, which is known to you as one of the smooth moves and singer, a tall drink of water with the R&B group, and my friend, Leaveil Degree and Tracy Degree. Let's welcome them.
That's what I'm talking about.
Right on, girl. Let me get my other friend in here. We also have today another beastie, but he's so corporate. But he's my client and my friend. Come on in here, Mr. President and name ad, Damon Lester.
Hey. Good to see you. Why you got to call me out? Why I got to be Mr. Corporate and they all laid back? That ain't right.
Well, you know how we do it. We know how we do it. So what's happening, everybody? How you guys doing?
Good.
Doing great.
Doing great.
Good. Ready for the new year.
Ready
for sure. I'm ready to get out of this year and start something new. For sure.
That's right.
Yeah. Definitely. Right.
Me too. I mean, it's been a busy year. And so I invited you guys on because I wanted to go back and look at my evolution and growth since I started this Roz Happy Hour. This is our 26th episode. But before I do that, everybody that knows me knows that I always have to toast. This Roz's Happy Hour. Cheers. Water. Got some water.
Great juice.
See, all you got alcoholics on
You're wrong for that. You're wrong for that. And that's what people be thinking. They be thinking, you know, like I've been drinking too much. But to be honest, you know what? It's happy hour, and we get a chance to bring people on and just kind of chill. And, you know, we never drink more than one glass. And so it's just a thing to do to say, hey, relax.
Right.
All that's in the news, we need something different. So,
that's
but
true.
We got a lot going on. So we're going to jump in here. Let me see if there's some comments and we can holler at anybody. Oh, there's Rick Reardon. Hey, Rick. So before we get going, we're going to start with my first show, and then we'll come back and we'll talk about it. So the first show that gave me an opportunity when I didn't even know what I was doing, I was in my office right out the box. So let's take a look at my interview with Marshall Thompson, just a couple minutes.
Wow. So, I mean, have you seen her? That went to the charts, but it was number one immediately.
One on the R&B chart and number three on the pop chart. Okay. And then when we had a chance to do the Flip Wilson show, Carl Davis says, take old girl with you. Now we say, man, old girl, that's kind of poppy. So all that country western keyboard and piano playing. Man, we took old girl to the Flip Wilson show. 4 weeks later, came on the charts at number one pop and number one R&B for 16 weeks. The biggest record we ever thought we were there, you know. And I mean, it just took us over the edge. And then came back as the number 36 record of the century, Old Girl.
Wow. Old Girl. Right now,
it's the number 36 song of the century. Elton John is number 37. Now, what? If you can name anybody in front of that 36, I'll eat your hat right now.
Wow. So that's, go ahead. I'm sorry.
Number 36 of the century. That's 100 years. You seen the award, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Number 36 of the century. If we never get another record in our life.
Wow.
We did what we set out to do.
Wow.
That 10 years of trying to make it was very hard. You know, going to different places, not getting paid, people running out on your money and everything, because they didn't know us that much. So they figured they could get away with a lot of stuff. But as time went, when we came into 1969, Give It Away came out, that changed the whole game.
Wow.
Yeah, that's history right there. Total history.
Wow.
Yeah.
Everything. In a century, that's huge.
Yeah, that's definitely huge. And yeah, you're right, boy, back in the day, we all got taken by promoters like crazy, you know, didn't get paid. And so, you know, that was a struggle, you know, for us. Most people don't believe that we even struggled during that, because, you know, they just see them, they heard And the Beat Goes On and say, oh, the Whispers been successful. They don't know we sung 14 years before we got our first hit. And the struggle he's talking about is real, because we were there struggling with them too. We were right side by side doing these little chitlin shows. So know exactly what he's talking about.
And he's actually the last Shy Lights left.
Shy Light left, yep. Last original left right now.
Yeah, the last one. Yeah. Wow. So all of these artists dropped a little bit of nuggets so we can pick up and share. So then, and look, I was in my office and I had my hand all in my face. I didn't know
how to do it. Now you got all these stars up behind you in your background. The whole backdrop in pain.
Hey, Leaveil, we were progressive except for those big old headphones that she got. Yeah, exactly. That's the problem.
She hasn't got to date with those yet. But Don't call her. She's not a technology person. She's going to make them half the size of maybe a third of the size. Hey, so
Rod's getting ready to is getting ready to land that helicopter in 2021. She's got going on.
Bell is a pilot.
No way.
And I'm a helicopter pilot too. So.
Identify. I can identify.
They were right at home for me. You know, I had to take them home, flying around a helicopter. So I figured she's gonna leave her show and get in a helicopter. And I'm surprised because Rosalind's so particular about her hair. I'm surprised she have anything that big on her hair.
Let's go to my next.
To get off of me.
So my next guest is Dr. Robert Franklin. He's emeritus of Morehouse College. He had just wrote a book, Moral Leadership. And so let's take a look. I'm trying to keep up with him. Hold on. And remember, it's Roz's happy hour. So hold on.
American men and preparing them to be successful in knowing that they would be faced with discrimination.
Yes. Well, I reflect on that very question,
Justin, Roz,
in the second chapter of the book. So while it's a book about moral leadership, I also think about and talk about the role of institutions that produce leaders. Mm-hmm. And that can be all kinds of institutions, schools, colleges like Morehouse and others, but also houses of worship, fraternities, sororities, all kinds of organizations can encourage moral leadership as I define it. Women and men who are possess integrity, courage, and imagination, and who serve the common good while inviting others to join them. And so the second chapter, I open with a photo, a famous photograph of young Martin Luther King Jr., still a teenager while at Morehouse. He's seated on the front row of the chapel. Wow. And I open with the words, you know, imagine what it's like to preside at a ceremony where there are 2,000 talented, energetic young African-American men seated there. And you know that these young leaders can change the world, can turn it upside down. Mm-hmm. And then I go on from there to talk about how the college culture contributed to that. And in particular, I tried to elaborate my vision, the so-called five wells.
Yes.
Most students are familiar with by now that I wanted all the students to be well-read, well-spoken, well-traveled, well-dressed, and well-balanced.
Talk about well travel.
Okay, wow. I need to wear my glasses for doctor.
That's great.
What are you talking about? Okay, yes.
That was huge on the five wells.
Yes, that was Morehouse. Fantastic. Young brothers were. He contributed to that, something that they needed to know, you know, well-dressed, well-traveled, well-read. So it was just an honor that he gave me an opportunity to come talk to Roz, for real.
I noticed the head stopped moving. The first interview, you kind of had the bobblehead going, but you stopped moving the head as much.
This one, I was trying to get my diction and everything together, and I was kind of stuttering a little bit. Nervous.
No, hey, that's all realism. That's but being real, you know, you got to be real even in the interviews. You know what I'm saying? You can't be what you're not. And you've stuck by you've always stuck right there in that. You never played the role for anything. Even with your glasses on, you know, it I didn't feel you were being faking the funk at all. So you did a wonderful job, definitely.
Thank you. Let's keep rolling.
I'm really happy to be here with you and through these troubled times. I'm crazy with this mask on, but people are here at my house and I have to kind of be safe, you know. But I did put on my Sunday jacket for you. And I'm happy during these trying times that we're able to connect. And I give God thanks. The virus, social distancing, this war against racism that we are now, that we're fighting. And, you know, Black lives matter. We matter. And I'm grateful that we're able, you and I were able to come together just off of a whim and talk about doing something together. We always talked about collaborating, but wow, at the most apropos time with the song that I wrote and produced along with my producer, James Evans, this song, Why? It's right on time for right now. So I had to address this song, but it's important to me, for me to address to my audience that though we are separated, that we are still as one.
Yeah, I know. I mean, I'm dying to let people see this video, but you want to talk a little bit more about it, then we'll play the video, then we'll come back and talk about it because, you know, first it was a pandemic, and then when I talk with you on Friday, George had just that broke the news, George Floyd, and you said, listen to this song. And when I listened to this song, oh my God, first of all, it brought tears to my eyes. Then you said, I want to get this out. I want to get this out. I want to get this out now. And I was like, Freddie, let's put some visual to it. And you said, okay, that was Saturday. You said, okay, give it to me by Monday. I couldn't sleep. I could not sleep. By Sunday, what, did I not have you a draft? I was like, it's so much there. I felt every bit of it.
Your husband gonna kill the both of us because he's like, what is all this midnight conversation that's going on between you and my wife? But you were like adamant, and you kept sending me all of these drafts, and each one got better and better. But your video really opened up a door for the words to come true. I mean, people have seen it and they're like, I mean.
Wow.
Yeah, Freddie.
Yeah, that was cool.
Freddy. Yeah, it was really
so
cool.
So Roz, I got a question, Roz. Why you didn't some take off his mask?
Because he had, you know, we were just getting started with the pandemic, and he had people in his house.
Oh, people were in the house. Okay.
Computers and all that. So right there, that was working, and so he, you know,
yeah, he covered up.
Right then, it was like,
yeah,
it up. We were expecting to go back to work in a couple months.
Right.
Because we all know try to go and try to talk with a mask on, where everybody you had that look like.
It was tough.
You had that look like I can't read your lips, so I'm just trying to listen as hard as I can. Yeah. So, yeah.
But I should have captured this one part. Freddie started singing, and I started singing with him because you know all of his songs are, you know, his songs. So I'm like singing. And he was like, no.
I was like, you singing? No. Wow.
You know, Freddie wrote a song for us too, you know, so a great song that, you know, on our new project that he wants us to do. And, you know, him and as a producer wrote this really, really, really nice song. So I want to give him props on that. So we can't wait to record it, you know.
Wow.
And then, you know, Freddie's typical thing, but I'm surprised he gave it to us because I think it's a smash. I really do. I think it's really a hit song.
Yeah. Well, he gave it to me, and he said, "This just sounds like the Whispers. This is so." And I was like, "It does. It really sounds like the Whispers."
Yeah. Well, thank you. Well, thank you and him because without you know, I mean, I'm glad he was able to get a hold of you, you know, and send it to us. But we were shocked. We were like, "Okay, Freddie sent us a song. Okay, what is this gonna sound like?" You know, people sending songs all the time. He's gonna give us one of his C songs or D songs, but he gave us one of his A songs. I was like, whoa, okay.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing it.
Yeah.
Let's say hi to a couple people. Good evening, Queen Roz, and special guest. Y'all say hi to Sherry.
Hey, hi, Sherry. How are you?
All right, who else we got on here? Wilford Elliott. What do you say, David? Wednesday blessings. Stay safe. Happy New Year's. Thank you. Happy New Year's to you.
Yeah, Happy New Year's to you.
All right, we got Indy in the house. Mike Jones.
All right.
Mike. Let's see, who else can we capture right quick? I know we've got a really big Whispers fan on it. This was a guy that showcased himself as a Whispers, but all right, we're going to keep rolling. We got a few more to go down. And I was still in my office then, and I was putting up people's pictures when I did Freddie. Noticed the posters in the background. I was trying to create. All right, here we go with Lenny Williams.
And Odia Coates that sang Having My Baby with Paul Anka. You know, we'd all be singing around. And then we go to L.A., then Andre Crouch and his sister, Sandra, and Billy Preston. And, you know, so we would do that. And then I started going to Laney College, well, Merritt College. And then I hooked up with Huey Newton, you know, him and Bobby Seale. And I was walking across campus one night, and I had my Bible with me. And then Huey, we got in a discussion, you know, about the Bible and the relevancy of Christianity, you know, during that time in the 60s, and that, you know, about the Ku Klux Klan, you know, that the cross was their symbol and everything, and just kind of questioning, you know, if Christianity was the, you know, the right path for us right now. And so I decided to walk away from church, and Huey recommended I read this book called Wretched of the Earth by Frantz Fanon. So then I was like, okay, I'm going to stop all this gospel singing and this preaching for a while. Let the white man have his own religion. And then, I was in my early 20s. And then but deep inside, you know, I was still kind of feeling it. So I was like, but if I stop, God might take my voice away from me. So then I said, well, I'm going to start singing. I'm going to use my voice to sing, you know, secular music or worldly music, as we called it. So then I started the showcase. That was Barksdale's other club, right? And so I started going down to the showcase singing on Thursday nights. Marvin Holmes had his band down there, and they would play anything you could think of, they could play it, right? And so I said, the key of the record? What key? I said, I don't know, the key of the record, you know? Yeah, just like the record, and they play it, and I just win every night. Yeah, so, you know, that was my preaching days, and, you know, growing up in the church, and I had a fantastic time in church. I learned a lot about life in church. Yeah. Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. You said, for me, I didn't know he was that. I didn't know that when he was, you know, in church like that. I didn't know that he preached and sang that but gospel. But, you know, when you listen to him sing, you can see where that influence came from. You know, he's really a good guy. Really, a really good dude. You know, we've done a lot of gigs with him as well. And he's just so personable, you know, and love Lenny, you know, style of his own. He'll never be forgotten.
How's it going, Ross?
Don't do that, Ross. Don't do that.
Jump in.
Okay, we want to keep our fans, so we not.
That's right. The Whispers got to go on the road in 2021. You can't mess that up.
You'd have to pay off. No, you can't mess that up. No. You'll see a show when it's professional, and they'll be after us when they see us too, but that'll help.
to learn that the Panthers actually, you know, got him out of singing gospel into secular, was like, oh wow, I didn't know that. You know, he was rolling with Huey Newton,
that's incredible. Yes, it is.
Yeah, yeah. let's go to our next guest, our next episode. Yeah, we're getting there. Hold up.
Gifted I was. Roz, there's a difference between gifted people and talented people. A talented people gain the applause of men at the end of the day. That was really good. Gifted people go to the hearts of their victims. Both of them are needed, but the gifted people are the ones that they really go to the heart of the matter. Those are the ones that really write songs that really inspire people to just be crazy amazing when they hear the music. Talented people are good, but a talented person can be taught to do something well. But I want people to know the difference, which is why he says every good and perfect gift comes from above, which means when you're gifted, you don't have to sound like everybody else or do what everybody else do, but everything you do touches the heart and it never fails. And that's why I tell people in production and things, try not to be so perfect, because when you're too perfect, you miss the heart. When you're singing, to me, everything doesn't have to be right, because sometimes that tone or that little move right there, heart can be healed if you have all the pieces, many of one, and you're not alone. The feeling, it just touches the heart. And so that's the kind of writer and producer I am. I like for it to be authentic. The note don't have to be always on pitch, because if it bends a little bit, I like all that right there. You know, not a criticism, just an observation. So the things and the songs that I've written, if you listen to my music, the message has to be stronger than one's voice and one's ability. Roz, if you ever hear a hit from Luther to the Tommies, to Shirley Caesar, to one of Kirk Franklin's favorite songs that I love, is when he first started. Someone asked a question, why do we sing when we lift our hands to Jesus? That song was just so true.
You're gonna have me in tears over here, go ahead.
Yeah, and so honest, I sing because I'm happy. I sing it just when it's real, from R&B to gospel to Beethoven. When it's real, it touched the heart. Marvin Gaye, brother. There was just real. And so that's Darius Brooks. I like, Jesse Jackson is like that too. Jesse Jackson, he has such a great ear for music. Being with him for almost.
Yes,
wow.
Yes, yes, yes.
Wow.
Wow. That was awesome. That was powerful. He dropped some jewels there. Awesome. That was good.
It's so funny. Wow. It's so funny. Everybody that he picked in the R&B world would be the people that I've always said the same thing. Wow. You know, when you look at Marvin Gaye, he may have a note that's not on pitch, but the essence of what he was trying to portray or say or make you feel, you didn't care. Same thing with Luther. You know, you go back and listen to some old Luther, you'll hear a note that might be a little sharp or a little flat, but it didn't make any difference because the run, what he was trying to make you feel, was more important than all of that. Wow. And it's funny that he mentioned those two people. He's so dead on. I wish I would have saw that interview. That's amazing.
Yeah, Roz, yeah, that was amazing. Me, you know, being the singer and being overcritical of myself. Wow. Yeah. You know, my husband always tells me, you know, it's not about being perfect, because I'm always, wasn't on pitch, you know, did I slide to the note a little bit? And it's not important. So it's really good, because, you know, as artists, we want to be perfect. Right. But you lose the feel. And even working with Ziggy Marley, he would look at me and say, just sing. And I'm like, well, no, I got to hit it right, you know. And there's times that I've sung songs live, and he just, you know, he'd look at me crazy because I'm so busy here and not here. And so it loses its feel. Doesn't matter if you're sliding on a note. And that's what Tina Marie was. I learned a lot from her, because but she taught me, and I didn't apply it until recently. And so, you know, basically it's not about hitting the note. If the note's right on, and there's no feel, and there's no heart, and there's no soul. What's the note? Why? There's no note. Yeah, you know.
No reason.
So to that was actually. That's I needed to hear that today.
Yeah.
I really needed to hear that. Thank you.
Can I ask a question of Tracy and Leaveil?
Yes,
Roz. So how do you know when to stop? So what's that period when you're doing a song, and to your point of, you know, it's time for, I can't be perfect with it. When did you, or who does that? Who tells you to stop? This is good. And your own inner being says, nope, I'm not done yet. So how do you find that balance?
Well, it's amazing because when we're in the studio, like if Scotty's doing a lead on a song, because Scotty's the kind of guy that he is like a lot like Tina Marie. Tina didn't know what she was. She knew the melody. She knew exactly what the song, the essence of the song. But when she came to the ad libs and that part that gets at your soul, she would just sing, and she didn't know where she was going. And sometimes she didn't quite get there. But it was the point. I mean, it was what she should have done. Same thing with Scotty. We can hear something that Scotty does, and it touches you inside. There's a thing that goes on inside of you, and you say, "Oh man, that's it." And then you that's it. You don't want to go any further. And a lot of times, the artists, they'll say, "No, man, I could do that better." No, you can't. You can't do it better. You had the right feel. You had the right notes. Yeah, it cracked a little bit, but it felt good inside. So that's when you have to literally cut a lead singer off at points, because he's always striving for perfection, but perfection is not always the right thing to have. And that's why he was so dead on. It was, I agree with everything that he said. And so you have to know it from, what's inside you. You'll hear it. And then you just say, okay, that's enough right there. You know, but sometimes you have to go over it several times to get to that point, and you don't hear it, you know.
Wow.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Hey, Danny, Roz, we can't hear you like the others. Oh, okay. Well, let me turn me up. Thank you. Can you hear me now? All right. Make sure you can hear me. All right. Sometimes it's good to go to the comments just so you can hear. All right. I was down a little bit. Love seeing all of the peers in the industry. Yes, thank you, Kimberly. Thank you. Who else we got in here? Okay, yes. All right, we're good now. Y'all can keep it now. Let's keep rolling. We got some more to get through. Okay, Damon, here's your boy. Let's go to JT Taylor from Cool in the Game.
I mean, you're one of those artists that have really, really cross to everybody. Your voice could change hearts and inspire many people. What would you say to the new artist today?
I think you said the key word, heart. Let it come from there. Mm. You know, people know when you're faking the funk. People are something, man. They could tell, you know. And I really believe that the artists have it in them, you know, what we do, what I did with the group. And when I think of, you know, Earth, Wind & Fire and all these unbelievable Tower Power, all these other bands, and then the solo singers, and you think about opera, the classics. I mean, everyone buys into something, and it's usually what you love most. And sometimes you don't know what you truly love. It's like by accident. I mean, I've come down here many times and did something and it's kind of whacked out, you know, but because you did it, sometimes you come back to it. Mm-hmm. I did lyrics and melodies. I said, oh, wow, I can take that from that song. You know, so I think when you're true to your heart, it will touch the hearts of others. And, you know, whether it's a dance song and party song and everything, even like, you know, even when you mentioned about rappers cursing and some of their music, it still resonates with people. You know, you go to concerts and everybody's singing every lyric. So it's difficult to put handcuffs on an artist. Mm-hmm. If you say that you're going to let them be an artist, then the way that they paint their canvas, day to day is how they feel, and that's the thing that should stay. And the restrictions, you know, exist, and the boundaries exist, but I still think that you need to always stretch the boundaries. Mm-hmm. You know, it doesn't take, you know, profanity to make a point at all times. But again, you know, who am I to tell another artist that, you know, this is not the way you should express yourself, you know?
Wow. Again,
yeah, that's true.
We're talking about to the heart,
yeah.
You know, and the profanity, I agree with him. You know, it doesn't take all that to express yourself in the song. That's why I hold true to old school, you know, the artists.
Mm-hmm. Yep. JT's one of the best out there. I remember when he first got with Kool & the Gang, and when I heard them, I said, there's not another voice that better fits that group. And what he did with that group was history. I mean, they had so many hits after one another. I said, please let somebody else have a hit. Let us have one. Everything he sung was, you know, was platinum, gold and platinum. So, yeah. You know, it was really a sad day when I saw him, you know, leave the group, because I still think that they could still make mucho magic together, as, you know, as him being the lead singer. But he's a bad boy, and his voice is so unique in itself. You know JT when you hear him, and that's what I loved about him.
Yeah, he was a performer, or he still is a performer.
Oh, yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. Performer. And they needed that, you know.
Yeah.
The front man, he was one of the best. Yeah. Or still is one of the best. I don't know what he's doing on his own now, but I know with them, he was the best. I mean, he was a great front man for them.
Yeah. He's still performing. I mean, well, like everybody else, not right now, but yeah, he was really popular overseas, and
okay.
You know, he has his own group.
I
wish they would get back together, but
yeah,
I don't know if that's going to happen.
Yeah, we haven't done anything with him here in the States, you know, and we've worked with everybody. So that's why I haven't, you know, kept in, you know, in touch with what he's been doing. But a lot of artists are real big overseas, so they can make, they can stay over there for the next 20 years and make a great living. So, you know,
yeah.
Good for him.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Okay, let's keep rolling. We're going to come up with the sextress, Miss Pamela Williams.
Oh, yeah, my girl.
Yeah. Yesterday was her birthday.
When? Yesterday?
Yesterday was her birthday. Yeah. Oh, happy birthday, Pamela.
Yeah, happy birthday.
Totally forgot to call her.
Yep.
My bad.
And Damon, you've met her too, because she's coming down to some of the gigs for us. So.
Yeah.
That's what she said.
Capricorn, that's right.
All right. So what's going on? Why they call you the Sax, Miss Sax?
Why did they call me Miss Sax? Well, I started playing saxophone in the high school jazz band. So I've been playing. I grew up in Philadelphia. Started playing sax in my high school jazz band, started playing professionally around Philadelphia. And I got my first big break in the music industry with Patti LaBelle. As you all know, she's from Philadelphia as well. And I was hanging out, you know, I wanted to be a solo jazz artist. So I was hanging out with a friend of mine. We were kicking it, listening to Anita Baker's Songstress album. So she picks up the album and she goes, Songstress, that's such a sexy name for an album cover for a female woman. She said, you should call yourself a Saxstress. So I said, that has a ring to it. I was like, I love it. You know, it's perfect. Saxstress. No one's ever used it before. So when I came out with my debut CD, I thought that should be the title of my CD. So that's where it started. And I've been using it as my stage name.
Wow, and you're from Philly. That's the Philly sound. I mean, what is it? Teddy Pendergrass. There's so many artists came out of Philly. Wow, that's what was that like?
It was incredible. I mean, I had so many influences. I mean, with Philadelphia International Records being there, everybody came there. The OJs, you know, Gambling Huff, Teddy Pendergrass, Patti LaBelle, Michael Jackson's came and recorded. Everybody came through Philadelphia International Records. So, you know, music was just a part of everyday life in Philadelphia. You know, it was everywhere you went, all the cookouts, all the barbecues, everybody. You know, music was such a big part of our life. And I like to thank my parents, too, because, you know, they'd be playing their old school music. Yeah, we call it old school now.
Yeah.
You know, they had some good music. And, you know, some of it I was like, but a lot of it, I really dug what they were listening to. And it really did influence me. So I call my parents now. And I'm like, I know we used to laugh at.
Oh, wow.
Wow.
Billy girl.
Yeah.
That's why they call her Saxtress.
Yeah.
Billy Sam. Yeah.
She holds it down. She's a bad girl. I've been trying to get her in our group. Wow. You know, so, you know, I really wanted her to, you know, to be with us that one time, or, you know, when we first, before we actually, I met her. I thought that maybe, you know, one time we thought maybe that Valentino was going to wind up doing his own thing because he had his own band. So I said, well, if he does, then, you know, she would be the person that I would bring in. But she is such a talented, oh my gosh, she's so talented. And we love her, you know. I met her along the same time I met my wife, too.
I remember that. You know? Yeah.
She's the reason why Tina Maria, the reason why we're together.
Yep.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, but yeah. Like I approached Pam to meet Tracy, and that's how she put it together. Tracy happened to be in a little dance contest with her pink, you know, painted on dress. I mean, you could see she had any body fat. She was probably down. She probably had 1% body fat at the time.
Not like now.
But I saw her dancing, and we're on a ship, and I walked up to Pam and asked Pam to introduce to her, and she told me she would, and she and it's history. Wow. We've been here 20 years, so.
Wow. Yeah.
That's a good story.
Yeah.
And so that's also why Tracy and Leaveil came on and surprised Pam on the show. She was like, I have a habit of doing that, you know, bringing on in the middle of the show to surprise everybody.
I
gotta holler at Marvin McIntyre. That's the man right there. I know you know him, Leaveil. I mean, Marvin, I forgot to holler at you with Johnny Gill. He's done the steps, the wardrobe. Marvin's been around the industry forever. When you coming on the show? Because I know you got some stories.
Yeah. Tell me how hard it is to dress some of these people.
Oh, there's Sonia. You guys know Sonia Ward.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, Sonia.
You know, that's Alonzo.
Thank you for my Christmas card.
Yeah, that's Alonzo, you know, our stage manager, Alonzo Ward. That's his wife. And Alonzo's been with us 30 years plus. So, yeah, we know her. Hi there, Sonia.
That's Walt. I was trying to holler at him earlier. Excellent story, Leaveil. We don't know which story because Leaveil's got a lot of stories. But Walt is a diehard Whispers fan, and he's photoshopped. I think when we had you guys on, he photoshopped himself as the fifth Whisper.
Oh, wow. Right on, brother. I'm not mad at you at all.
I don't know if he can sing. Oh, who else we got? Okay. Oh, Dante.
What's
going on, Dante?
Yeah. You know who Dante is, right?
Yeah, Dante
is ex-drummer. Yeah. Still a bad boy. I've been watching some of his thing on, he's been doing some live tapings too, you know, and Dante, you still got it, brother. You a bad man. So I've been enjoying that. Yep.
Yeah. All right, let's keep moving. Y'all don't mind? Y'all sure you don't want to drink? Can I get you a drink, Damon?
You got it.
Okay, you good? I've been sipping, so we're all right.
Damon's on the East Coast, so thank you for being here with us.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Poconos, huh? Okay. Are you just hanging out there or you live there?
No, I'm from Philly. I live in Maryland, but I'm here for the weekend with my kids.
Oh, wonderful, man. And now you're working.
Now I'm working. All for Rise.
All for Rise. All for Rise. Got some friends that love you, girl. I've been like, I'm here with the Poconos, girl. Please, don't be bothered. Yeah.
It's just nothing but love.
Dante, what part of Philly?
What part of
Philly? I'm from West Philly.
You know, she's a Philly girl.
Where she is.
Southwest. I'm from Southwest.
Yeah. Cops from
47th Street.
Come on, Jake. Come on. Are you serious?
47th Street. Yeah. Near West Catholic.
My mom was the principal of West Philly High. Yeah. And the Catherine School. She was the vice president, Catherine, on, I'm so bad with the streets now, but West Philly.
Yeah, West Philly's is closed now. They're doing something to it off of Spruce Street. Yeah. Huh? Yep. So I got a lot of family in Southwest right off of 55th, 56th, and Osage. And
yes.
A lot of family over there. Yeah.
Yes. Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. You know Pam before? Oh, sorry.
No. No, I've never met her, but I've met her before. I never knew she was from Philly, but I had met her before with Roz.
Okay.
Yeah. Roz, I'm a full of our for us for the auto industry.
Yeah.
All right, let's keep going. Let's keep rolling. See what Roz
from Philly all day.
I know. We don't. Okay, here we go. This is Narda Michael Walden.
Oh, yeah.
This was awesome. Hang on.
We are 35 years later. And then we know the second album of Whitney, she came here in this room for I Want Dance and He Loves Me. And
wow.
That whole album. So God bless us, you know.
Yeah. So she get it right in one take, huh?
On How Will I Know, she would sing it about 3 or 4 times. Mm-hmm. But each take would be so devastating, you'd be knocked out.
Wow.
Then the challenge would be for me as a producer, right? Producer is how to comp her. Comp means how to put the best parts together. Because you want to think, like, what's going to live the longest life? What's going to be like you can listen to over and over 100 times and not get tired of it? Mm-hmm. So that was picking out the best parts, putting it together seamlessly. Then that's the record. Yeah.
Wow, that was in it. Mariah Carey, man, you just killed on that. That's my girl. I love her vocals. Just saw her in Vegas.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, great, great, great show. So you also had ASCAP award.
Yeah, we haven't opened it yet. It just came this morning. I traded the box. But I have to open it. Maybe you can film me opening it. Okay, hold on. I'll film it myself opening it for you. Because ASCAP says whenever I open it, they want me to film myself. Yeah, we're back. This is the ASCAP award.
Oh,
Jimmy, are you filming?
Nice.
And I'll open it right now. Yeah.
Oh my God.
I'm going to open this. It says ASCAP Awards. Let's see what it is. It just came in the mail this morning.
Oh, how fortunate is that? Here we go. Come on, Narda. Come on, Narda. Look, let me let the people see.
Okay. Yeah. Let's see what's going on here. Let's see what's going on. Let's see what we got in here.
Look at that. Narda Michael Walden, Gratitude, Sky Music. Beautiful.
We're so happy because this was a smash for Chris Brown. That was a smash for Shawnee Wilson, I Love Your Smile. And Chris Brown loved that song, took that song, I Love Your Smile, and made Undecided. And Undecided has been played so much because people love I Love Your Smile, and they love what he did with it. And it's a smash all over again. So we're very, very happy this time. We congratulate Shawnee Wilson, who we adore, who we want to make more smashes with. We congratulate Chris Brown and his production team as well. We want to make more smashes with them. And we want to keep music going. We're very happy this time to receive this award from ASCAP.
Wow.
He unveiled it on our.
That was awesome.
Bro, that's cool, Roz. You couldn't talk any better.
What'd you say? I'm sorry.
I said you couldn't have talked that any better.
Oh, I know.
Yeah.
Really. Awesome. Yeah. Wow. And to he told us a lot about working with Whitney Houston. So that was really nice.
Yeah.
You know, but I'm trying to just grab some of the nuggets from some of these shows and throw out there. So that I was excited to have Narda on the show.
Great producer, you know, did a lot of wonderful things. Never worked with us, but put that in. So if you listen, you never worked with us.
Well, he told me out there that he's looking
for us. We're still alive. We still can sing.
Yeah, he told me to put it out there that he's looking for people to work with. So, you know, we make a connection.
There you go. There you go.
That's what I do.
That's what you do, Ron.
That's what I do. I'm an agent. That's right. All right, let's keep rolling. We have Chris Walker. I don't know if you guys know Chris Walker, but Chris Walker was Al Jarreau's protege.
Oh, I didn't know that.
He came up under Al Jarreau.
Oh, okay.
Here we go. Chris Walker. Chris. Oh, hey! I thought I was in the wrong house. Yeah.
The new school, Gil Goldstein, and he said, I received a call to do some orchestrations for this singer by the name of Al Jarreau, and we need a bass player. Would you be interested? I was like, would I be interested? Are you kidding me? So they flew me out to LA. I quote unquote auditioned, read the music and stuff. And afterwards, Al hired me immediately to do the tour, the orchestral tour. And afterwards, Gil called me to my room. We were in Canada. I'll never forget it. He said, I need to talk to you. I said, okay. And he said, well, I better come to your room. So I'm thinking that, you know, Al fired me. So he walks in and the first thing out of my mouth is, you know, tell Mr. Jarreau that it was a pleasure to work with him. And thanks for the opportunity. He said, well, actually, he would like for you to join his regular touring band. And I was like, wow, really should. So I joined Al's regular band and shortly afterwards became his musical director, and the journey into Jarreau land began.
Time for change in the land of the and the home of the brave. Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring. Time for change. Living in a world where people are dying every day, it's time for every man to have an equal chance. The future's now and we must all take a stand. Right the wrong for general alone. Tell me what when you've given your all, seems like you can't make it through. Will you just stand when there's nothing left to do? You just stand. Watch the Lord see through. Yes, after.
Wow. Went to church.
You had a concert going on, Roz. That was awesome.
Yeah.
I mean, there's so many songs that were at the time with George Floyd.
interrupted.
Excuse me, y'all.
Well, no, you know, we went to see Al Jarreau at a winery in California just before he passed. It was probably one of his last performances during that period of time. And I was just asking her, was he the musical director at that time? She said she didn't. He probably was until he passed, right?
Yeah.
Because I remember the face. I thought he was. She said no, but. He was there until he passed, right?
Yes, he was there.
I remember seeing him.
Yeah, and he's making a name for himself now. Yeah, he's on all of our cruises. So, Damon, he's so talented because he can scat like Al Jarreau and do all those notes. He makes his voice an instrument.
Right.
He makes his voice an instrument. So. Yeah. That's what's incredible about Chris Walker. So we're going to keep moving.
Yeah.
I won't keep you guys too long. Hold on. Gerald Albright. He dropped us. Yeah.
Did they name Smooth Jazz after you?
Yeah. Well, you know what's interesting? A lot of people think I'm a smooth jazz artist, but I've been around for a minute, Roz. You know, I was doing records way before the term smooth jazz even surfaced. It was called instrumental R&B, or it was called contemporary jazz. You know, which it has a bit more energy rhythmically than smooth jazz. Smooth jazz is a little diluted, a little watered down from what I'm used to doing. So. And see, I did recording sessions for groups like Earth, Wind & Fire and Rick James and folks like that back in the day. So the way I hear music, I hear it in your face. It's not like real pretty and calm. You know, I like it to get it right on the speaker where it's in your face and people are grooving immediately from note one. And that's the way I've always heard music. I've heard big arrangements, you know, horn, string, you know, not just, you know, rhythm section and a horn. You know, so that's just the way I write. That's the way I hear things. And I'm just thankful that people love what I do.
Yeah. Well, can we check you out? I mean, I want to check you out. I mean, everybody knows you that's here, but let's check out what I was able to capture in the Mediterranean Ocean. So hang on, y'all. Let's see if we can get. Do you want to cue it up? Let me see. I think I got it. Let's check it out.
Boy, I spent all night on him.
Yeah, yeah. You
know, his brother was married to his brother Bill Albright was married to my sister, and Gerald's played on several of our songs. You know, several of them. He's the one guy that you send him the bad part about, and I don't even know if you would call it the bad part of Gerald Albright, but like we would send him a song to do a solo on. And by the time you finish the solo, you wanted to keep the whole record just like he played it, because he would send us a thing where he'd do the solo, then he would take and just play through the song so we could use whatever we wanted. But you wanted to keep the whole thing and put it out on Gerald. That's how bad that boy was.
Wow.
So it was amazing working with him. And I got one thing to say to him if he's looking at this. I called you, brother, and you're supposed to be calling me back about Colorado, and you haven't called me back. So what kind of stuff is that? I know you big, but you ain't that doggone big.
You heard it right here, right here. Right. Hey, Glenn Dixon. Wow. What you talking about over here, Walt? Of course, Gerald does some of our Whispers song. Did he say
our Whispers? Our Whispers songs.
I am not mad at you, Walt.
Hey, he is claiming it. He wants the uniform right now. He wants the suit.
Oh, yes.
That is cool.
Yeah, let's keep going. So we're going to shift real quick. So I went from, I say that our motto here is to bring you the best in arts and entertainment. So I brought in an artist, a real artist in Leaveil. And Tracy, you guys appreciate this because they're artist buffs. So check out Chaz Guess.
Like wonderful greatness that you are. So if you don't mind, can we go to the video? How about that?
Hit it.
Well, I don't know if it's gonna be that smooth, but I'm gonna get it going. Hang on, y'all. Okay.
Blade hang in some of the most prestigious homes across the world. As do his geishas with their depiction of global citizenry. And then there's his portraits of kings, world leaders, prima ballerinas, superstar musicians, and icons in business. Paintings his high-end collectors covet and commission. Quite a feat for a self-trained artist who's defied every convention and helped put the LA art scene on the map.
I hope that my paintings serve as sort of like an ushering of what true humanity is, I guess. I think it would help people to see people as people.
Wow.
There you go. I'm glad that you showed that LA Stories, that Giselle Fernandez. As a matter of fact, you know that is nominated for part of the Emmy.
Emmy. Oh my goodness, congratulations. Yeah.
Was nominated for Emmy, but the LA Journal Award or something like that. I forgot, but that should be very interesting.
So I want to holler at a couple people that's saying hello. That's Laura Blake. Very talented. Yes, he is. So Chaz, we have so much to talk about. I know that you were invited to Switzerland. Can you tell us about that? I mean, that was an amazing opportunity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'd like to like back that story up and just tell you, you know, sometimes, you know, I talk about this a lot. I used to say that, you know, life is full of like magic, but in fact, life is you have sometimes a chance to walk in divine favor. And I'm going to.
Wow. See, he was starting to get deep on me.
You getting ready to get deep, wow. Right?
He was getting ready to get deep, but that brother is a magnificent, brilliant artist.
Yeah, it's gorgeous stuff. Beautiful stuff, yeah.
Yeah, wow. He's got some nice, nice work. He painted Jolie, the one that was married to Brad Pitt.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
her daughter. Angelina. Yeah, he painted her daughter. So that was, that was pretty tight. Okay. So that was an interesting little switch, you know, and, you know, music and art goes together. So,
Roz, you've had some heavy hitters this year. You did a good job.
Thank you.
Really good job.
Know the depth of you, who you are, because I'm there. I'm in the R&B world, but I didn't know you were in all of these other different worlds, the artist world. I mean, you've been, people that have made social changes in the world. I mean, you've been dabbling in a lot of different areas. Yes. Yeah, this deepness to you. Drink, huh?
What did he say? Behind all that champagne you drink.
And so, Roz, you have definitely been able to reinvent yourself, even with COVID and doing this virtual podcast. So it's, you know, kudos to you to being able to stay to your brand and use your network to pivot into a whole new realm of what you've been doing. So that's definitely awesome. And this is not easy to put on a Zoom or a podcast. It's probably the most stressful thing than doing something live out there, because there's so many things that's moving around at the same time. But you've done an awesome, awesome job.
Yeah. Yes.
Thank you.
I know you've encouraged us to do the same thing, but we lazy. That's all. I'm not gonna put it any other way. We got excuses. We got straight up lazy, and that's why we talk about it. We're vigorous in talking about it, but it ain't happening.
Yeah. Well, it is.
It's not over.
And Damon knows it is work, but it is my only out that I've had. I'm going to almost start crying because, you know, with me and my husband being high risk, we've been completely locked down and isolated. We haven't seen any family. We haven't seen anybody. So the only outlet for me was to get busy, figure it out.
Right.
It can happen. Stay connected, you know. And it just came to me in my sleep. I woke up and said, I found this software, StreamYard, and I jumped on it and taught myself. And I'm still teaching myself. So, right. You know, that's what I said. Let's get to our evolutions where, you know, it was in my office. That's why we called it Roz's home office. And then I sort of grew like, wait a minute. We gotta, you know,
yeah,
you know, add some other things to it. So thank you guys for being
proud of me. From day one to the first episode to now, Roz, I mean, it's the difference between day and night. And you always want to see people elevate themselves, and you have definitely done that. Definitely.
Yeah, and you've had A-lister hitters on there that people really don't get a chance to interact with and see. And to your point, you know, COVID has definitely shown that, you know, this person-to-person interaction is so important for all of us, you know, right. Whatever industry that we're or field that we're in, that it's so important for us to have physical touch and just to be able to interact and see someone face-to-face. And it has definitely been a lonely period for a lot of people if we haven't had a chance to interact with folks. So you, kudos to you, Roz.
That's great. Thank you. You know, I want to piggyback off of him because he's so right. You think you need it. As artists, we need it too. As you see, I mean, people, artists, you know, they're human beings. Even though they're, you know, people look at us different than what we are, we're still people, and we need that interaction. We need to be connected to our audience, our fans. And if we can do it through this means, it means as much to you to have us as to us to be with you, because this is the only connection that we have at this point, you know, because I'm high risk too, you know, and my wife is on my butt policing everything that comes around. She's not letting anybody hardly in this house. And she's always reminding, 6 feet, 6 feet. You know, she's always screaming. I'd be outside and I hear a voice out of the window. So, you know, but we need this. And you have been you've been that catalyst to that. And we really appreciate you.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you. I've made mistakes, but you know what? You never give up. You just keep going. And you know, thank you guys out there for supporting what, you know, I'm trying to do. Just give artists an opportunity and us an opportunity to still connect in COVID. The idea was to turn the TV off, turn the news off, turn CNN off. Yeah. It's too much. We need at least a day where we can drink.
Wait a minute, Leaveil and Tracy, do you see how empty that glass is? So when the hell have you been drinking?
You have so much. Yeah, they should have seen like that because we try to be killing for in between.
That's why she's been letting them cook roll a little bit extra longer. She over there tipping his glass. That's what's going on. I see you, Rod.
Say, why are you calling me out?
But it's hard. It is definitely hard to start something new and do it and execute it and then always want to improve yourself in doing it. And so you know, we all try to have evolved and tried to pivot and recreate ourselves this year. And, you know, Leaveil and Tracy, you as entertainers, you feed off of people, right?
That's right.
And it's hard to get that sense of adrenaline to feel when, you know, we're at this screen. And so you guys have realized what you've been able to do for the Whispers, Leaveil and Tracy and others is give people that feeling back,
right?
Just to be able to interact with people. So,
and what's job. What's, I'm sorry, I'm going to cut you off, Damon. Because if I don't get it out, it won't come out. But what's also important is, I think as entertainers, we're all really trying to find out who we are. You know, all we know, I mean, you've had what, almost 50 years of it, close to 30. Who are we without the rah and the, you know, the stage and the lights and the glitter and coming off the tour buses and everyone doting on you? Who are we? You know, just, you know, I can't get my lashes done. You know, I'm just me, which is great, but we're all trying to figure this thing out and we won't get it together. Like, we're not going to go back to work until 2020, you know, so
2020, you mean?
I mean, sorry, 2022. See, I'm already COVID brain.
Right.
2022. So, you know, this helps, you know, this is like therapy for us, Rosalind. Mm-hmm. So we thank you because we put up a front because we're used to it and we have to, even on stage, we have to show that we have no issues at home because we're there for the people. But the same, my husband and I are like, okay.
Well, good thing we love one another, because if we didn't, we'd be divorced like a son of a gun.
It is a time. And that's something I want to touch on, because there are couples that are both in the music industry, that our industry is closed completely. Hospitality industry is closed. So when you have two people in the household that is used to being out on the road, you know, now you're coming together and you're home more, together more, you're really learning each other.
Exactly. Learning each other over again. And so that's why the divorce rate is so high right now, because people, even with 9-to-5s, they really don't spend much time together if there's two people working in the family.
Yes,
they come home, you know, they got to be around one another for 24 hours. They're like, I don't even like you.
Exactly.
I never paid attention to, because I only spent about 3 hours before we were getting ready to go to bed, you know. Yeah. You know, us as you know, like you said, she is the entertainer, I'm an entertainer. So when the work shut down, we had no choice. Not only did we had to be home together all the time, but there was no income anymore for either one of us, you know. So thank God we prepared. We didn't prepare for this, but we prepared, you know. But I'll tell you one thing, you can complain about stuff. But when they say, when you never miss your well until the water runs dry.
That's it. You know?
And any artist out here, whether they're in acting, they're singers, or whatever the case, whatever they do, they will not, I don't think anyone will ever tell you that they don't miss their people, their fans, their audience. You know, that's the one thing we miss the most. And not for the doting and stuff like that as much, but we just miss the work. And miss being able to perform and show our craft to people. So, you know, I can't wait till we get back. So people, let's wear these masks. Let's do what we got to do to get back to work.
Amen. Amen.
That's right. Amen.
Be still. Okay, we got a few more. Let's keep rolling. You guys still with me? A few more.
All right.
Here we go with Miss Regina Bell. Music with R&B, because I know I'm at the concerts, I'm at the club, and I'm dancing and moving. And then when I go to church, I'm kind of mixed which one I'm supposed to be doing. So I'm still growing in that. And I was just wondering.
It was difficult for me at first growing up in church.
You know, we were always taught that you can't serve two masters. You can't, you know, you got to pick one or the other and the whole nine. But I don't serve two masters. I serve God. I love God and I believe in Jesus. Mm-hmm. And I let folk know that in the club. I let folk know that at the arena. It really don't matter where I am. I could be in crib at the grocery store. And I let somebody know real quick who I serve. So yes. It's I'm not ashamed of who I am and what I believe. And I let people know that because I don't want people to think that I got here by the pulling up of my own bootstraps. So, yes, I'm going to sing Baby Come to Me because that's the song you paid to hear me sing. Alongside that, I'm going to also sing God is Good. I find a way to get it in there because, you know, I believe that God is everywhere. And if he's only in the church, he's not really a worthwhile God, is he? I mean, if it's just about being in the church and if you're talking about light canceling out darkness, well, in the church, we're supposed to already kind of know about this light. So it's like light in light. It's like null and void. And I'm not saying that everybody go to the club is going to hell. That's not what I'm saying. Right. What I'm saying is I want folk to know in the church as well as in the club that we still have a God that's waiting for us to let him in so that he can fix what's broken, so that he can be a friend to the friendless, so that he can offer some guidance to those who have no clue as to where they are, and to overall just be your God. And give him praise. So at the end of the day, it really don't matter where I am. And I used to let naysayers determine how I felt about being in ministry outside of the church, doing it, being doing in the clubs, and after you know I was so called. But you know, God told me that your ministry is not in the church. I need you to go back to all of those places that you went to. And I need you to talk about me where the folk in the church ain't going to go.
Yeah, that's so poignant.
Wow.
Yeah, that's so poignant.
This is good stuff, Ron. Yeah. I'm learning so much. Well, the stuff is just refreshing what I already knew.
Yeah, because I was wondering, you know, like I'm in the music business and I'm rocking and rolling. And then I'm going to church, standing the first one in the on the pew, you know. So how do you draw the balance? You know, well, the music is good.
There's a balance of at everything. Like she said, you know, you know, there's heathens in the church and there's heathens outside the church. But God didn't say that you can't minister to them. Not, you know, you know, if you just count on the church to do that, I mean, it, you know, yeah, that's going to be there. But you know, I've had people walk up to it when we put out our spiritual album that we had. And I've had people walk up to me and say, you know something, that album that you put out, I was going to get an operation and I was on my way and across the radio, the song came over the radio and I was listening to it and it gave me a sense of peace about the surgery I was about to have, you know? And so that made me feel good and we stood there and she said a prayer for me, you know, and, you know, it was just, it was a great experience. So you can affect people through your music and through your lyrics. And, you know, she has been a person that's been, I mean, even since she talks about Baby Come to Me, the way that she sings it and the lyrical content is still, it's respectful and it's about somebody she was in love with. And that's what... Right. Whispers, everything that we put out is something that depicts love, not, you know, I'm going to, you know, I'm going to hit it in my Jeep or, you know, my shorty. It's not about that. It's about lyrical content that actually talks about love and God is love. So why are we not talking about it? I'm not saying go sleep with this man's wife. I didn't put out a song like that. You know, it's about love between two people. We're balladeers. We sing about love. So there's nothing wrong about that. You know, it's just you got to be responsible in anything you do. And Regina's one of the greatest at that. And her voice is just
amazing.
Amazing. Yeah.
Amazing. Yeah. Okay. I'm going to skip over some of these because we got some more. But Let's see. Let's go with, I had to go from, okay. So why don't we lead into our time with the whispers? Fun interview.
Here we go. We are right back here again. And that's why this new song means so much. The question is how long are we going to have to put up with this? Yeah. Like Scotty said, we done lost the names. We can't even talk about it. There's so many names. Mm-hmm. You know? But yeah, seems like I got to do wrong. We were asking that question back then, and that was 40 years ago.
Wow.
Well, let's bring it up to date. Back then, they didn't have cell phones.
That's true.
Mm. They do have cell phones, and that's the blessing. Mm-hmm. But now, because of that cell phone, we can show you what we've been trying to tell you for 40 years.
It's true.
You know, we've been saying how long for 40 years that Black people have been being mistreated. We've been stopped by the police. Mm-hmm. You know, we've gone through everything you can think of, and we were standing way back then. Now you got a phone, and you got a phone with a Google on it, so you can Google up and tell them and find out anything you want to know about whoever you want to know. Mm-hmm. So that's the blessing of the day. But this is not the first time we've seen Black people being mistreated. We saw it back. As a matter of fact, we ended up years ago, and it's a very short situation, but we ended up having to go, of all people, the country singer, his name was
Johnny Cash.
Wow. We ended up in his studio running from white people.
For real.
That's right. You
know, we got caught in one of them towns back there.
Oh, yeah.
South, and we got in the wrong place, and we had to get out of there. And he's the guy that said, hey, you can come to my place. So it's been going on forever, but now you can see it.
Yeah. Will we take you to find ourselves again? Won't you tell me about this? Be strong.
Oh, the master plan. Get those things right on the other side of your reality. With the winds that blow up where you can be. Then the universe is for all to see.
Wow.
Wow, flashback.
Were you in that video, Tracy? I swear I could have saw you.
Yeah, she was in there. My old neighborhood was in that video. Yeah, we called on them and they came out and showed up for us.
It was beautiful because literally we, you know, it's all types of nationalities and races in our community. And they were there for us. Yeah. Called them and said, look, just show up in our alley. I'll tell you what it is once you get here. And when they got here, I had one.
We don't live in the alley, show up on our block. But show up in our alley.
But no, they showed up for us. So they, you know, we had them spray painting love on sheets and walking the streets. What is it? Love is the answer.
Right. Wow.
I tell you, these were people from Cirque Soleil that are our neighbors and just wanted to be a part of it. So, yeah. And at that time, I think everyone was trying to figure out their part in this whole pandemic thing. So, and they wanted to be able to, you know, just do something to show love.
Yeah.
Unity. So they ran. We had about how many? 20? People
no,
out there,
about 15, 30 20, people.
About 30 people.
Yeah,
wow. 30
people. And so that the hook where it says how long, yeah. You know, all holding their hands up, and then we had a drone. We had two of our neighbors had drones, and they brought those out, and it was beautiful to see. They said thank you because we had grandkids that said, you know, what are you doing about, you know, the Breonna Taylor and the and what it was George Floyd.
Yeah.
And grandpa and grandma, like, what are you doing? And they're like, well, we don't know what to do. We're not Black, but, you know, so that gave them a sense of purpose.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That made a lot of sense.
They didn't want to leave. They're like, okay, video's done, but it was beautiful.
Yeah, that was great. Good. Okay, yeah. Let's go to a comedian. Our next one, Mark Curry.
Mark Curry. Boy.
He's off the hook.
Oh, yeah, he's off the hook. He's off the chain.
Why is Happy Hour been taken over by Mark Curry? I want you people to go to Mark, to Instagram, the real Mark Curry on Instagram. That's some real shit, okay? And make sure you support my girl Roz and Clemmy got me out of a situation once in the hood. We were deep in the hood. We don't want to talk about it. And I was deep in situation I shouldn't have been. Girl, me and Clemmy used to go out. You didn't even know about that.
Mm-mm.
Oh yeah, me and Clemmy used to hit boy. Eli Mile High Club. That was his place. He was asleep. He'd come out completely different. Change clothes. We changed clothes, boy, in Hilltop parking lot. Clemmy from the all-white suit. Said, nigga, don't call me Clemmy. I'm Diamond. They call me Diamond. I was like, all right, let's roll. Me and Clemmy do that. Yeah.
Oh, my God.
But anyway, I'm your fitness man.
Oh, God.
So come close the door. Let me give you what you're looking for. I've been waited all day long. Think about it, ladies. Put yourself up to the speaker. Look at that deep baritone voice.
Oh,
come on now. I know you had a lot of lead singles on this goddamn Rise's Happy Hour. I know you did, but you ain't had me. I know you had Eddie LaBerg. Eddie, you know me, Eddie. You can't out-sing me. What? Brandy? Come on now. I know these, you know?
Oh, my
Whisper.
God. Yeah.
I know Scotty. Scotty!
What's that?
Scotty can't hear. Hey, Scotty, huh? Scotty, why you they always got to call your name? Scotty, huh? Be with the group, Scotty.
Oh, my God. Oh my God.
Dennis Edwards. Come on.
That's
right. Laura Blake even said, yes, baby, making music. Stop it, Laura. I take that bit back. You can't say that, Laura. Even Laura is saying that. Baby making music. That is baby making music. Because back in the day, we didn't have to talk. Now you got to talk to a lady. Back in the day, you put on a Teddy Pendergrass album, he did the talking.
Yeah.
Am I right? Close the door. You just said what he said. Why don't you close the door and turn off the lights? Bam. And light a candle.
did you get to say anything, Chris? You didn't get to talk at all, did
you?
He is out of his mind.
It's crazy. You're always calling your name.
funny brother, definitely funny brother.
Oh my God.
I just watched him on Martin Lawrence. As Martin Lawrence, one of his sitcoms where he was a lawyer for what's her name? Martin Lawrence plays one of the
Shanaynay.
He was a lawyer for Shanaynay, but off the chain.
Okay, so we're gonna get through a minute. You guys, I appreciate you for staying on with us. It's a little longer than we planned. We are gonna say New Year's, Happy New Year's, but let's just keep rolling.
Okay.
Trying to figure out where to go. Let's go to where are we gonna go? Okay, this is David C. He's staying with Dennis Edwards and the Temptations review, but check out these nuggets he dropped.
Guy named his road manager, Tunis Wilson.
Tunis, that's my boy. Yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And they were sitting there listening. Tunis was kind of amazed at what I was doing. And he asked Eddie, why don't we get him? That'd be a good addition to the group. And Eddie said, no, he probably wouldn't want to fool with us. But anyway, they took me to dinner after this recording session and asked me would I join them. I tried to act nonchalant about it, you know.
You didn't want to be like excited.
Yeah, I couldn't wait to say yeah. Okay. So.
Just because I raise a little sand. I might be tired, lady. Why do
understand. It doesn't mean that you done something wrong. And just because when we have a little fight and I walk out the door and stay gone all night, it doesn't mean that I won't be coming home. Yeah, yeah. I love you. Oh, I love you. What else could I?
Station group, Dennis, that was David and Eddie. They took me a long ways, you know. I mean, I've been to every country almost. Almost, I've been all around the world. Let's put it that way. And I've seen all of the big time artists. I mean, from James Brown on, we've been on shows with all of them. And I can only just say how thankful I am to have been among those three guys that would.
Wow. He was with Eddie Kendricks, David Ruffin, and Dennis Edwards. Okay. So he's one of the few that's still here that's actually worked with Eddie Kendricks. And he learned a lot from them. So that's why it was important for me to showcase David C. He is just phenomenal.
What was the name of that song, Roz? Drink up, Roz. Go ahead and drink up, Roz. No.
I love you. Why?
I love you, right? And I've never heard that song. That's awesome.
Me neither. I've never heard that one myself.
Yeah. And that's one of his favorite songs that he made. I will send it to each of you to have.
Yeah, please. So, that's cool.
Yeah. Let's keep rolling. I want to do my pastor, and I'm going to do Tommy Smith, Morris, and Eddie and Johnny, and we'll be out. Okay. All right, here we go.
Since you're my spiritual leader, I need to ask a question. So, and I think you know me a little bit.
Yeah, that's why I'm already laughing.
How can I stop from going to jail if I run into a Karen? Because praise God, I haven't ran into one. But if I run into a Karen, I don't know if I could be so cool. I mean,
that's why you got to spend time with the Lord daily so that you can grow in the fruit of the Spirit. And one of the fruit of the Spirit is self-control. And let the Holy Spirit give you what you need when you need it. You know, you may not need it right now because you haven't run into to such. But if you do, you've been walking with the Lord and talking with the Lord through this, then He'll give you what you need, no matter what else impacts you. You know, you'll have what you need. And let me just pause there just to say, encourage everybody that's listening and watching to please make sure you take advantage of this time with God. You know, this is a great time for you to settle down and develop discipline, like daily discipline, to spend time with God, to read the word, to pray, to worship, to listen to some gospel music. You know, listen to your other music too. Do your thing. You know what I mean? I love music. I love all kinds of music. I'm a musician, all of that. You know, so I'm cool with all genres of music. But make sure that you spend some time with God every day, that you pray, that you read the scriptures, that you worship, because it's going to help you in ways and at times that you cannot begin to imagine. So feed your faith and starve your doubts.
Ooh, somebody put that in the comments. Feed your faith and starve your doubts. That's what I'm talking about. Yes. So
nice.
That was on point.
Yeah.
On point.
Yeah,
that was deep and well needed right at that time. We needed to hear that. Feed your faith and starve your doubts. You know, we got to keep believing. All right, let's go to Tommy Smith, Olympic 1968.
Had to be addressed some way. I had to do it to make a change. I wanted to stand out very clear and be on the platform in terms of human rights issues.
Wow. Well, do you still, you're the only man in history, track and field, to hold 11 world records simultaneously. Yes. Do you still hold some of the records today?
Well, believe it or not, I still hold two world records, which will never be broken because that race is not run anymore. That's the 200 meters and 200 yards on a straightaway. 19.5. Mm. And I did that in 1966.
Wow. Man,
that's just a long time. A lot of the people who are listening to us chat here was born in, and I was out running in college, sitting in those boring history and biology classes. Yeah.
Yeah, that would be me. So Usain Bolt, the Jamaican, former sprinter, and you ran the same race?
Oh, yeah. Hussein Bolt, I think you're speaking of.
Yeah.
I ran 400 meters also. I held a world record in the 400 meters as well. In 68, I held two world records. The 200 meters proceeded in 1968 and the 400 meters in 1968. I held both world records. But I didn't run, as you know, the 400 meters. Mm-hmm. We had guys on the team just that good. The world record holder in the 400 meters didn't have to run the race to win a gold medal for America. We had athletes on the team as good as I was in that race. Mm. So Lee Evans ran that race and set a world record. In fact, Lee broke the record that I set on him a year before because he was in the same race that I ran my world record in the year before.
Mm.
Yeah, so like, it's a lot of history that people don't know. A lot of the nuances in those races that historically people don't know because they only highlight of what I did in Mexico in my race and nothing else. I was a high jump. I jumped 6'8" in high jump, long jump 26'6" in long jump. So I did a lot of different things.
Wow.
And don't ask me why didn't you become a decathlete? why should I run 10 events for one gold medal?
Yeah.
I wasn't stupid, you know.
smart man.
Yeah, and he still got that gold record, and he still holds a record, and he's historical.
Yeah,
I mean, I asked him about the relationship between his stance and cabinet. You know, it was the same thing. They weren't fighting for the flag; they're fighting for it was a human rights issue. So I walked away.
Didn't they give him his medal back? Didn't they wind up reversing it and giving them their medal?
He always had his medal. They always thought.
I thought they took him from him. I thought they, back in the history that they took the medal from him or something because what they did in protest wasn't cool. And then they just reissued, or not that, well, I'll say not just, but just reissued.
And I asked him that question, did he still have the gold medal? Because the rumors was that they took the medal, and he said no, that was not correct.
That's
he
good. Has
the medal.
That's good. Yeah, they shouldn't have. I mean, they earned it.
Yeah.
Right.
And Tommy Smith is actually Clemmie's cousin, so we actually saw the medal.
Oh, wow.
So,
what happened with the other guy? Because it was two of them that raised their hand.
Yes. Carlos, he's here. He's
he's still around?
Mm-hmm.
He's still around. Okay. Okay. Yeah.
We just favor Tommy because this Clemmie's cousin. So,
right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, that was we're gonna go to we got three more and we'll be done.
Okay.
We're going to Morris Chestnut.
Oh, Morris Chestnut.
Bank. And banking. Yeah. So I really thought that was gonna be, but then, you know, it was funny. So the first time I said, man, I have to pursue this.
So I started pursuing acting. And by the way, it's something that a lot of people in LA get around to doing that anyway, because it's LA and everyone's doing it. So everyone tries it at some point. But I'd never really even thought about it until he told me about it. And so the reason why I really wanted to pursue it was, me and a couple of my buddies, I got an agent, and the agent sent me an audition for A Different World. It was a sitcom around that time that was paired with the Cosby Show. So it was set in a fictional black university. And the girls on the show, they were going down the cafeteria, and my character was serving them food. And, you know, they were kind of flirting. And so I just kind of smiled and said, I had one word, the word was hi. You know, they broke my hi. And so it was funny. So what happened was, so my agent called me and said, listen, they want to put you on Leaveil for a week on the show. And basically, when they put you on Leaveil, they just find out your availability. Say, is he available? Because if we cast him, we want to know that he's available. So they tell you, so they say, we want to put him on Leaveil for this show. And, you know, if we cast him, you know, we're going to give him $1,500. Now, this was years ago. And so I was like, and so he called me. And when he was telling me the information, I did the math. I said, $1,500. So I said, they want to pay me $1,500 for the week just to say hi. So if they want to pay me $1,500 for the week to say hi, how much are the leads getting? And so so I was really just motivated, you know, to come into the industry for, you know, the opportunity, many people do come into it. They're kind of just, you know, they want to be seen. They want to be heard. They want to be known as a star. And that's never been my objective at all.
So your birthday is New Year's Day. Get out of here. It is.
I'm a Capricorn. Yeah.
All right. Happy birthday, Morris. Well, let me just say that Damon came in and surprised Morris. They are very, very close. So we had a good time on that show.
Wow.
Yeah, we left with a lot of nuggets as well. And Damon, you want to speak on that interview with Morris?
Man, that was so much we talked about. So Morris is in the auto industry. He has a dealership.
Okay.
And so one of the things that, you know, Morris and I had discussed prior to him going into the dealership realm or owning a store was that he can't pass acting off to his kids. And when he said that, I said, okay, he ready. He got it. So he said, you know, I want to be able to have something that I can pass down for my kids, because, you know, what I do, it's a finite number of years that I can do this, and I can't pass this off to them. So I want to be able to have some inheritance for my kids. And once he said that, you know, he did everything that, you know, we asked him or advised him to do. He went to dealer school while he was still filming his TV shows, and he was flying back and forth from LA to Virginia, where the dealer academy was. I went to the academy with him. And he did. He's doing extremely well.
Okay.
So he's been able to. He has a Hyundai dealership in Claremont, California.
That's beautiful, man. That's great. That's where you know, and that's why I was telling you, most entertainers don't understand that, and he understands it best. I mean, he's a handsome guy. He does a lot of roles, but that could dry up in a hurry, like it already has. And he can still rely upon his dealership to sustain his life. You know,
absolutely.
And people don't understand the importance of that, you know.
Yeah.
And that's always been my focus, that you got to have something going on. And then, even though at my age now, I tell her all the time, I got to find something that I'm passionate about. And cars have been my life. My father brought me up into it before I could even get behind the steering wheel. My father brought me into it. And so for me, I have such a passion about it, you know, so we will be talking. I tell you.
So you're in California?
No, I'm in Vegas now.
You're in Vegas.
Yeah.
So Reggie Jackson, baseball player, does
is does something similar to it. And actually, we just helped Reggie get his first dealership.
Oh,
at 70.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, he's older than me, or older than me?
No, he's 77.
He's 77.
Yeah.
72. Oh,
yeah.
I know.
Yeah. So now we'll definitely connect offline. We'll definitely connect.
Jesus Christ.
He's trying to act like he's 50. You just called him out.
They go on Google. You can Google the whispers without the degree.
Let them Google it. I don't want you to.
I'm saving it.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Come on. We got two more. Let's go to Eddie LeVert and see.
We'll talk though, brother. Definitely. Yeah.
Let's check out Eddie LeVert.
Oh, wow, Rob. Wow. 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 We've been friends a long time. Long time.
Long time. But guess what? You have always been cordial, nice, cool. You just always let me, you know, be around you, and I appreciate you for that.
like I said, you and Clemmy has always been great people, and you know, you don't run into that many people that can last that long with you, because mm-hmm. show business is a fickle business and people go and come in and out. But one thing about you and Clemmy, you've always been there with me, and you know, through the ups and downs, you're one of those people that you know, I've always been up with you, not down, not ever.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for bringing us so many years of great music. Do you miss the stage right now?
Somewhat, you know, but now that the pandemic and the quarantine is in, I get a chance now. I have other passions, and now I really get a chance to do a little painting, and I love to paint, and I've been doing some a lot of painting and doing a lot of writing, and now I've moved my studio into my house, so now I can do my vocals. Like if I want to get up at 3 o'clock in the morning, I can just go in the studio and start singing. So that has been a great thing for me. I really mean it. I miss it because now we're going to do virtual. And now, like tomorrow, we're doing a virtual performance for a private party. Mm-hmm. And I don't know how that's going to affect me, because the only thing virtual that we have done was doing the Biden and Harris campaign. We did Love Train, and we did Got to Give the People What They Want, and Biden and Harris. And so that was my first time doing a virtual kind of work. And it just seems, you know, there's nobody screaming and there's nobody clapping and there's no, it's just like, okay, I hope they like that. I hope they appreciated that. I hope I did a good job.
Yeah.
Good brother there. Good brother. Yeah. People don't know how funny Eddie is.
Yeah, he's hilarious.
He's hilarious. He'd come to your dressing room, boy, and have you laughing your butt off. But mm-hmm. one thing I can say about him, and I tell her all the time about, he is one brother that his performance, and he's done a lot of performances, a lot of shows, but he gives 150% every time he performs, you know, and I don't know where he gets it from, because I can't do that as consistent, but every time I've seen him, I'm like, I've asked him, how do you do that? You give 100, he's like Nicholas. Nicholas gives 150% every time he performs.
Yes. And
Eddie's that same kind of brother. He gives his all in all, and I've worked with him. We worked with him and toured with him and the OJs really, and it's been great. And we have great concerts, great audiences that come out, and it's just been a pleasure to work with him all these years. From my 47, 53 with the Whispers. So you know,
wow.
Wow. So let me see, 43, 53, 72.
Yep.
47.
Yeah. 47. Oh, now see, there she go. 72.
Over to
there she go. Okay, all right. Even up on me now, okay.
You know, but I've been doing Eddie for over 30 years.
Yeah.
So,
and you know, so you getting back, you're getting in return what you give, what you and Clemmy have given out, you know, and that's what you're getting. Oh, that's why you have these people coming on your show, respecting you. You know, you've always thought about the artist first, you know, and I've always appreciated that about you. You know, you're not, you know, if we wanted something, if you could get it, you're going to get it for us, you know, and artists remember that. They really do. So that's why you're getting all this love back, you know. And you got the, you've had a show that's been this successful. What is next year going to, I mean, next year is even going to be greater.
Yes, thank you. I pray. All right, well, let's wrap it up with Johnny Gill. Let's see what we got. This was a fun one too. Hold up.
Listen to your heartbeat, girl. You know, feeling better than feeling on your body, girl. Don't you move a muscle, cause I just want to touch you. If you ever took, I need you to look at your woman tonight, man. I want you to look at your woman and tell her, yeah, I'll die right here today. So I'll give her everything to you, because I want you to know that.
Bam! Please give him a warm welcome and welcome my friend, Mr. Johnny Gill.
Hey. How are you?
I'm good. What's happening? Welcome to Roz's Happy Hour.
Thank you for having me. I'm hanging in there just... I've been having those, one of those days where there's a million things going on at one time, but it's still a blessing.
Yeah,
working on some great stuff, working on good things, that staying busy.
Well, what you drinking tonight? This is happy hour. You have a drink? You got some water or something?
maybe I can get a shot or something.
Yeah. Okay. You're also the oldest of the new edition guys.
Yes, I'm the oldest. I'm the big brother, the oldest.
Yeah. Well, have you guys been able to check on each other during these times?
Oh, yeah. We were on the phone last night for about a couple of hours, actually, just talking ideas and just talking and goofing off, laughing and acting stupid. But we were all on for about at least a couple of hours. Yeah. Last night, yeah.
Oh, good. That's good.
Yeah.
And have you learned anything new about your about yourself while you're in quarantine?
I like myself.
But
I learned that I like myself. I learned that, you know, it's really cool to know that you could be alone or could be by yourself and be okay with that. That speaks volumes. A lot of people move around a lot and always moving and jumping around because they clearly need, can't sit still because they're running from something. And so it's amazing to see that I could be this comfortable in my skin, could be this comfortable to sit, watch TV, don't have to worry about not sitting there worrying about how much company I need to have, how many people you need to have around you just to make you feel, you know, or blow smoke. You know, I don't need any of that. I just learned it and feel like I'm just as content just being here and being, you know, by myself and just reflecting and having time to myself, something that hasn't happened in 30-something plus years.
Wow.
So true. So true.
Yeah.
That's a good question, Ron.
Yeah. Make a difference. I mean, you know, but I had to cut off. I had to kind of blend that one together. Because me and Johnny had a good time.
Right.
We had a good time. So
he made some really good music. He has made some great music over the time, you know, and one song that he got that we were shocked that he got, not through any factor that he couldn't sing the song because he did a wonderful job on it, but we were slated to record that song and we didn't know that he recorded it until we went to the record company, and we're sitting there talking to the president of the company. He says, I got this great new artist, and man, we just did this this smash on him. And he said, okay. He says, I want you guys to hear it and tell me what you think. And my came on. And I was like, we were supposed to be on next week.
That was
what the heck?
That was a whisper song.
And Babyface decided to do it on him and didn't tell us. Yep.
Yeah, he talked about that on the interview.
Yeah,
he did.
That's some fighting words right there, Leaveil.
Oh yeah, we were in there. Because that was going to be the sequel to what we had done with him, Rocksteady and stuff like that. And so we're like, okay, man, we got this new smash that we're getting ready to do. It's gonna really, send us to the moon. And then he played that song as a new artist, Johnny Gill. Let me let you hear the song that we cut on. He didn't tell us that Babyface or who the producer was. And then all of a sudden we heard my, and we were looking at one another like, and we didn't even say anything to him, about we were supposed to cut it. We were just in shock. We're like, I can't believe this.
I bet you some cuss words when y'all got out there. Oh, man. I know some good cussing out there.
That was one of the songs that got away from us.
Those are a lot of stories and like that.
Catapulted his career. That was his debut song. Yeah.
And we got to shout out Grady. Today is his birthday. Happy birthday.
Grady. Yeah. One of the best directors on planet Earth. Yes.
Wow. Well, I want to thank you all for joining me tonight to do a walk through, our evolution of shows and artists. And, we had some cameras and non-cameras. We had some audio issues and non-audio issues, but we got through it all. And, I'm grateful for you guys that came through tonight, Damon, Leaveil, Tracy. Thank you so much. Finish this year, this Wednesday.
Yeah. We want to thank you for allowing us to, go on this journey with you, and you thought that much of us that you wanted us to be a part of it. We really appreciate it. And next year, is going to be better than ever. We're going to be blessed in so many ways. We're going to continue to be blessed in so many ways. And we're just so happy that you feel our friendship is, our friendship is close enough that you chose us to, go on this journey with you. We really do. We don't take nothing like this for granted. We appreciate you and Clemmy unbelievably. And me and Damon going to be best friends in a little while. So
that's right. We will definitely talk.
Yeah, brother.
Good guy.
I can already tell he's a good cat. I can tell his heart is in the right place.
Because he's from Philly?
Yeah, maybe.
That's right. Philly.
Maybe I'll get some clout because my wife is from Philly and he's from Philly. So.
What? That's right.
Yeah. Well, hang tight. We're going to do a New Year's out and we look forward to coming back January 6th we're going to start with some funk. We're going to rock out with Zap. Ooh. And then we'll come back with some jazz with Mesa. So stay tuned for our
NERE. If you can grab her, I love her too. So, you're going to work it out.
Roz, before you wrap up, Roz, just let me real quick. Just big shout out to Clemmy. I've known you guys for about 20 years, and Roz and Clemmy has definitely been a part of my family and vice versa, part of their family. And it just shows the duration of how important relationships are.
Ooh,
and, and And by us having these relationships throughout the years, it just shows the importance of it, you know, that that stands the test of time. And yes. And Roz is a friend and also a business affiliate as well. And we've been able to marry the two. And that's my go-to friend. And her and her husband have definitely looked after me and vice versa. So Leaveil and Tracy, you now part of the family too.
Oh, yeah.
You know, anything I can do to help you guys, you please let me know. I got you.
Thank you so much. Yeah, you. I'm glad you brought up Clemmy because Clemmy is such an important part of this whole nucleus, you know, and I know that he knows what kind of wife he's got because I watched her in action when this when his brother was sick, and she ain't no joke with no nurses or no doctors. She is a beast on him, and she brought this man back from the brink of, you know, who knows where he was going to go. She said, I am not losing my man at this time. And so I know that Clemmy knows what kind of woman he has. And if all of us as Black men had a woman like, well, I do, I'm very fortunate, and I'm probably, you do too, Damon, but it's very, very hard to find that woman that's got your back no matter what, you know. And I always tell people, it's okay to tell me you love me, but will you wind up, you know, changing my diaper if I can't do it? You
if
know,
you can't do it, yeah,
can't do it, you know. And I know that I got one that will be right there and make me still feel like a man. And Rosalind is what represents that for Clemmy. So, you're a good woman, girl.
Amen.
That's right.
Great sister too.
Yeah. So I try Rosalind next. I guess we'll talk about it later. But I try to get Rosalind to join me on this natural hair journey.
Oh, Lord, Jesus.
I'm just trying to figure out my
thing. Jacked me up.
co-washing.
I saw her too, and I was like, oh, go back to your straight hair, Rob. This has been a journey for me.
She was so in it with me. She's like, yeah. I was like, come on. Yeah.
I'm going to tell you something. Damon, I know more about hair than any Black man should ever. Any man should ever know. I know more about hair and chemicals and, and relaxing. Oh, and
porosity and everything else. Porosity in my baby.
You're a low porosity. Right. I don't even know what the porosity. I don't even know what porosity means. But
yeah, and there are different grades of Black women's hair.
Yes,
everybody's hair can't go home.
No, that's a good one. That's a good one.
What did Clemmy say? What did Clemmy say to you?
He said, "Hell no."
I said, "Roslyn, come on, what products did you use?" She's like, "Let me show you a picture."
Wait a minute. And then somebody came to the door and they're like, "Sir, can we?" I'm like, "Sir, I ain't no."
Yeah, that's time to change it back.
Yeah.
I was like, okay.
Don't worry about it.
It's not working for me. It's not working for me. So.
I don't know what I'm going to get every morning. I just wake up to it.
No. All right. Well, thank you. Yeah, Colas, that's Clemmy's cousin. How about that? All right, you guys, hang on. Laura didn't get to say hi. They are good friends to have. Yes, she is amazing. Hi, yeah, let's say hi to Roberta. See, we get info behind the scenes, but if it didn't stop the show, Leaveil. I didn't follow that. I missed it. All right, let's go to some fireworks. Hang on, y'all. Let's see what we got going on. Hold on. Happy New Year's, everybody.
That is cool.